and welcome to the Tudor Her Story. Today I am talking to Sophie Bacchus-Waterman about her research for her upcoming book, Elizabeth Boleyn. Sophie earned a Master's in Book History from the School of Advanced Study in 2023. Her dissertation focused on the commission of the Psalter of Anne Boleyn. She has three papers on her research into Anne Boleyn's Psalter and household forthcoming in the next year. She has spoken on her research at the Taylorian Institution in Oxford, at the 13th Annual Kings and Queens Conference in Paris, and she has appeared on the podcast Talking Tudors. Outside of her work as an independent scholar, she's the Special Collections Photographer at St. John's College in Oxford, where she digitizes their manuscripts and early printed books. Her forthcoming book, The First Solo Biography of Elizabeth Boleyn, is due out with the History Press at the end of next year. So, on to today's talk. Hello, Sophie. How are you?
Hello, I'm very well, thank you. Very excited to be here and share my research about Elizabeth.
I'm really excited to have you on. As I mentioned in the introduction, we are discussing Elizabeth Boleyn, who I can't wait to learn more about. But firstly, we'll talk a little bit about yourself. And I was wondering, when did your interest in history begin?
So I've always enjoyed history when I was in school. I was blessed with some really great teachers in primary school and secondary school. So I really enjoyed visiting historical sites, and I grew up in Tunbridge Wells, which was near Hever Castle. And one of my earliest memories is actually going to Hever with my grandma and my sister. So I've always had a love of history ever since I was a kid.
I'm going to pretend not to be jealous that you live so near to Hever Castle. It hurts. Would you say being so close to Hever Castle is what drew you to the Tudors?
I don't know specifically if that was it. One of my earliest experiences with the Tudors that I actually paid attention to, obviously being, you know, a small child going to Hever, I didn't really understand the connection, was actually a visit to a place called Kentwell in year five for on a school trip. So that was a local hall where Tudor reenactments took place. And I remember going there and having just a great time. Everyone was dressed like it was the Tudor period and everyone spoke, you know, in an old fashioned way. And I remember having so much fun on that school trip. That's really when I first started to pay attention to the Tudors. And I remember learning about the six wives of Henry VIII, and I learned about Anne Boleyn. I particularly, as a historian now, cringe, but I remember learning that Anne had six fingers in school, just as a fact. Oh, it pains me now. But my real love of the Tudor period didn't begin until I saw the Showtime show, The Tudors. And I think I speak for a lot of people when I say that that really was my introduction to Anne Boleyn as a figure and the period in a real serious way. Mm. I know that a lot of people take issue with The Tudors as a TV show because of its horrible historical inaccuracies, but I allow it a lot of leeway because I think that it captured the emotions so well. I cried when Thomas More was executed in that show. I cried in the finale. I thought that it was just such a emotive, well-filmed, beautifully executed piece of television. And it was a wonderful gateway for myself, and I know a lot of other people, into studying the real history. I think that, you know, when you have historical dramas, I allow them a lot of space to be less accurate because they can often capture the emotions in a way that reading a dusty old document can't do. I realise that was a very long answer, I'm sorry.
No. I completely agree. The Tudors was like, obviously you learned it in primary school and you got basic introduction, but the Tudors, I was introduced to it by my mum, because admittedly when it came out I might have been a bit too young to watch it, so yes, I watched it when I got to the teens.
I think it was a bit steamy, wasn't it?
A bit steamy. I mean, I remember quite distinctly when I was younger, when, you know, she was watching it for the first time, and it was the scene with Cardinal Wolsey where he does something to his neck.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And she was like, get out.
No, you can't see this. That's one that I allow. I think that it's going to sound grim. I think it might be my favourite scene in the whole show, and I know that sounds incredibly morbid, but the juxtaposition of the music and the pageant, or the, you know, the dance that's going on, and Wolsey's prayer, it's so wonderfully acted and it's so beautifully shot, and it captures the emotion, even though it's not what happened. Obviously Wolsey did not commit suicide, but it's such a well made, crafted piece of television. You know, I can really see why it was your kind of introduction to the Tudors as well as a period.
I think as you say, it was just beautifully executed. Like, I know obviously there was a lot of historical inaccuracies, and some of them are really frustrating,
yes,
in a sense, because they quite clearly did their research to a big degree, and then they chose to ignore some things, which can infuriate people.
Absolutely, absolutely. I completely understand why people, the costumes are atrocious.
Oh yeah, they're so bad.
Yeah, the costumes are terrible.
I love Natalie Dormer as Anne Boleyn.
Me too.
I know some people don't like her as Anne Boleyn, but she's one of my favourites. She's up there.
I agree. I think she might be the best portrayal of Anne, personally, to me as well, because it's so complex and so emotional. You really feel it. The scene where, I realise we're here to talk about Elizabeth Boleyn, and we will in a minute, I promise, but you asked me a question about the Tudors, so I'm on. The scene where Anne is begging for her life and the with Henry, and she has Elizabeth in her arms, again, based in historical sources, perhaps based in historical evidence, but so well put to screen, so emotional. And that is, I think, why a lot of people allow it a free pass, or at least why I do, because you feel it, seeing it on the screen in a way that perhaps more staid and historically accurate dramas like Wolf Hall, for example, also wonderful. I loved Wolf Hall. I thought it was fantastically done from a costuming standpoint, from a more of a historical accuracy standpoint. But with the Tudors, it's the high drama, it's the music, it's it as a complete package that I think really brings a lot of people to the period.
No, I completely agree. I think the Tudors, a lot of people view them from today's eyes.
Yes.
And I always say you can't do that with the Tudors, because we can't judge the actions of a 16th century person, because it seems insane to us, but to them it was completely normal.
Absolutely. And I mean, it's something that, you know, I'm sure we'll address later when we talk more about Elizabeth. The gap of 500 years, we cannot pretend that we understand that mindset, or that we can understand those people. Obviously, throughout history, you can say, you know, generally people have always been people, of course. But there is something about that mindset of the 16th century and historical figures from that long ago. It is a world that we cannot even begin to understand. We can try, and as historians, it is our responsibility to try and reach those people and to give them a voice, or try and understand why they might have done what they did, how they acted the way they did, and trying to let the sources speak for themselves, or historical figures where you can, but also understand that there will always be a gap, whether it's a gap in primary sources and evidence, or it's a gap in our understanding of their mindset, or it's a gap of who wrote the source, you know, very basic sort of GCSE, who wrote this source and for what purpose. But I still think that we need to be very careful, of course, when we apply our modern lens onto the past.
No, I completely agree. When did you first discover Elizabeth Boleyn, and what inspired you to research more about her to make a book?
So when you research Anne, you inevitably read about her mother. And I was curious about if there was more information, because I noticed that there was a gap. People would mention Elizabeth Boleyn briefly in biographies of Anne, and I've always been interested in overlooked and understudied figures in history. So Elizabeth Boleyn's life has been researched by other historians. I'm not going to say that I am the first one to ever do it. Off the top of my head, Elizabeth Norton's wonderful book, The Boleyn Women, is a really good example of that. But Elizabeth had never in her own right had her own biography. And so I wondered why that was the case. And I spoke to some other historians who said that they didn't think it was possible to write a full biography of Elizabeth, that there wasn't the surviving primary evidence for it. And I thought, that sounds like a challenge. Let me just see what there is. So I decided to see what I could find, if I could put together a full timeline of Elizabeth's life using easily accessible primary and secondary sources that I had on my shelf or that were accessible online before doing a deep dive into primary sources, for example, at the National Archives, the British Library, the College of Arms, just to see if it was possible to chart Elizabeth's life from birth to death using easily accessible sources. And I found that, in fact, it was, that we have a lot of evidence for where she was as a teenager, that we can place her at court at several points in her life, and that we know the year she died. And so that gave me a very basic framework from beginning to end. And then I think of it like a body almost. So the bones are the primary source documentary evidence. So where her name appears in seating charts, where we know, or household accounts, or where we know where she was on particular dates. And then to connect the bones, you have the connective tissue, if you like, of educated speculation. So that is sometimes called speculative biography. So, for example, we don't have direct evidence for what Elizabeth's day-to-day life at Hever looked like for certain periods. But we know what women of her station running a household did using other sources. And so you apply those sources to Elizabeth's life and you say she would have been, you know, doing this, that or the other at that point, where you can't directly say we know for certain what she was doing. And then there's also a technique called reading against the grain, which is where you read a primary source at a slightly different angle. So, for instance, we know, and I'll talk about this a bit later, we know that Elizabeth had a position in Catherine of Aragon's household for a period of time. And so where you have accounts that talk about Catherine's ladies were at this joust or at this pageant, there you place Elizabeth. Even though we don't have any direct references to her, you know that she was in Catherine's service. Therefore, where Catherine and her ladies are mentioned, Elizabeth would have been. So that's how I filled in a lot of the gaps where we don't have direct evidence. And it was really fun. It's like being a detective, you know, trying to find this figure where you can directly, and then searching indirectly where you don't have the evidence.
I mean, I think it's really fascinating. I think, you know, Elizabeth is really overlooked, as you say. It's especially when it comes to TV programmes that we've just been discussing. In the Tudors, she's not even there.
Yeah, she's not there in the Tudors. She's not there in the Tudors. She appears in The Other Boleyn Girl, which I think is a very good portrayal. And then she appears in Anne of a Thousand Days as well.
Yes.
But she might as well be dead for all that she appears in Anne's biographies or in television portrayals. But we know that she was very important to Anne.
Mm.
We know that because we hear it from Anne herself. And so for me, going on this journey, doing this research, it really was very important. I began to feel very strongly. I mean, I did when I started, but only through the research is it this feeling growing stronger that actually here is a figure who has been overlooked by history. She was there. She was there even if we can't directly see her. And someone had to do this. I felt quite strongly that somebody had to try and put her back on the historical map as far as it was possible.
Mm.
Not claiming that I've found, you know, letters written by her. I wish I had. I wish I'd found a portrait. I wish I'd found a trove of letters that had been overlooked. I have not. But it's just about reassessing the sources, because that's all history is, isn't it?
Yeah.
Reassessing the sources. The sources haven't changed unless something new comes to light and we find something new. And new discoveries are made all the time. I hold out hope for a contemporary portrait of Anne Boleyn appearing one day in an attic. Until that happens, all we can do is reassess the sources through new eyes and try to find new ways to tell, in this case, very, very old and familiar stories.
No, I agree. I think that when there's, it's a bit like, it's a bit like with Anne Boleyn, it's, you think you know her, and then if you actually go back at the sources and look at a different level, you see a bit of a different story, but it's how you evaluate it. And obviously, Elizabeth Boleyn, as you say, was probably there a lot more than we realise.
Yes.
Because who was I talking? I was talking to my mother last night, saying, yeah, oh, I'm going to be talking to this lady about Elizabeth Boleyn. She's like, oh, that's interesting. And I was like, I don't get why she's not talked about more, because she was a Howard.
She was a Howard.
Queen.
So I will be spoiling the book a little bit here. It's in the is very much, you know, work in progress, but I talk in the introduction, why has nobody done this before? Why do we overlook Elizabeth Boleyn? And I have two main theories about why that is, besides obviously a lack of surviving sources and, you know, the fact that she's not front and center. We don't have letters, we don't have portraits. If you put that aside, why has Elizabeth Boleyn been overlooked? And I think that it is because she doesn't fit into the two stories that we tell about Anne. So on the one hand, Anne is a victim of the men around her, the victim of the machinations of her father. And if that's the case, then that does not allow space for Elizabeth Boleyn. Perhaps we don't want to apply the same negative stereotypes that have been applied to Thomas, to Elizabeth as a woman. We don't want to imagine that she was vindictive or that she might have had a hand in forcing Anne into Henry's bed, as the accusation has often been leveled against Thomas Boleyn. Obviously, the wonderful research of, you know, Dr. Lauren Mackay has really overturned that belief about Thomas Boleyn. That, I think, has led to Elizabeth being overlooked. The other way that we look at Anne Boleyn is that she was a vixen, you know, a femme fatale who tempted Henry away from his rightful wife. And if we think that's the case about Anne, then we cannot allow for the fact that we have documentary evidence for that Elizabeth Boleyn was actually present during Anne and Henry's courtship for a lot of the time in order that no impropriety might happen. So because we've got these two images of Anne Boleyn as a victim or a vixen, her mother does not fit into either one of those stories. And because we're retelling Anne's story over and over again through those narratives, there has not been space for Elizabeth. And I think as well that we don't like to imagine, I think it was Sylvia Barbara Soberton who said, we don't like to imagine that Anne had female friends, that she was supported by the women around her, which therefore extends to her mother. We want to imagine that Anne was a proto-feminist, a strong woman who didn't have female friends and who didn't perhaps rely on her mother or look up to her mother. We want to imagine that Anne was a strong woman in her own right. And so giving her a close, loving relationship with her mother, which we know she had, one of the few things we can say for certain about Elizabeth Boleyn is that she was close to Anne. That is, I think, why we have not looked into Elizabeth's story, because it doesn't fit into the very well-worn stories we tell about Anne.
No, I completely agree. I think it's a thing of all humans. It's we have to have everything fit into a box. Mm-hmm. It can't be, you know, the Venn diagrams. It can't mix in the middle. It does have to be separate. And I think you're right, because there's not space for Elizabeth, but because no one wants to be like, well, no, if Anne Boleyn's a vixen, then how can she be liked by other women? How can her own mother like her? And then if she is a likable person, why is her mother letting this all happen?
Exactly. And those are questions that I haven't been able to answer. You know, there's no interiority. I will stress this because this is the first time that I'm speaking about the research, like on a platform in this way. I've not found letters. I found some new, really exciting documents that I can't wait to talk about, you know, in the book and to share with people. But they don't offer us interiority. I have not had that. But simply by tracking Elizabeth's life from birth to death, it has granted me, I think, access to what she might have been thinking, what she might have been feeling, because all we have is where she was at certain points, what she did at certain points. And through that, you can suggest maybe she felt this, maybe she thought that. And some people won't like it. I know there are people who will read the book when it does come out, and they won't like it because they'll say there's too much speculation in it. But I think that with historical figures where we have a lack of primary direct source evidence, as we do with Elizabeth, should they not be afforded at least careful speculation, rather than saying, well, I don't know, I guess we'll never know, let's not even try to talk about that figure. Then how do you talk about people, a majority of people who lived, we don't have a lot of direct source evidence for. How do you tell those stories where we don't have the surviving evidence? You have to speculate carefully and make it clear that you're speculating. But I think that we should, as historians, be less afraid to speculate on what people might be thinking or feeling, where they might have been, what they might have been doing.
No, I completely agree. I think it's obviously we can do educated guesses about how people are feeling. Obviously, you know, you can't put words into their mouths. We don't know how they felt. But realistically, if Anne couldn't do anything about the king's attentions, what could Elizabeth do?
Exactly. What could her family do? What could her family do? It's been very interesting. At the moment, I'm just writing about Anne's coronation at the time of recording. But when I was writing about the courtship, speculating on what Elizabeth might have thought about it, what she might have felt about it, all of that, I'm sure we'll get into it later. That was very interesting because obviously we don't know. But we also don't know what Anne thought about it. We like to think we know a lot more about Anne than we actually do.
Yeah.
But if you look at the primary sources themselves, we don't have, for example, her replies to Henry's letters. We don't know what she felt. We can only infer. Often we can only infer by the evidence of the men who were writing about Anne. We'd like to think we know a lot more about Anne than we actually do.
Yeah, I think people like to say that they're good friends with Anne. It's like,
yeah.
No, sadly not. We don't know what Anne was thinking at all. But it is a lot of inferring. I get what you mean. It's with even big figures at the Tudor court, it's still a lot of inferring. I think even with Henry VIII, there's a lot of, we don't actually know what he's thinking or feeling.
Yeah, and we can't. It's their interior world was so completely different to what ours is now. The way they saw the world, the way they thought about themselves, they were not, I think it was, no, actually, sorry, I was going to say something, I've forgotten, cut that part, just leave it there, say they weren't, leave it there.
Yeah,
I was going to say something, I forgot what I was going to say. Crop it.
What can you tell us about Elizabeth's childhood and family?
So Elizabeth was born probably in or around 1480 to Elizabeth Tilney Howard and Thomas Howard, the Earl of Surrey and later second Duke of Norfolk. So the Howards were, as I'm sure a lot of the listeners know, one of the premier noble families in England at the time. Elizabeth's grandfather, paternal grandfather, John Howard, had been made the first Duke of Norfolk in 1483. And her mother was the sole heiress of Sir Frederick Tilney. And the Tilney family could trace their line back to the time of Edward the Confessor. So Elizabeth really was born at the top of society to a very well-regarded and high-status family. And she had a lot of siblings. So she had 10 full-blooded siblings. And her mother had been previously married to Humphrey Bourchier, who died in the Battle of Barnet. So Elizabeth also had several half-siblings. It's like everyone was related to the Howards. Everyone was related to everybody else. It was incredibly interwoven. She had a lot of siblings. But the most historically significant ones were Edmund Howard, who would go on to be the father of Catherine Howard, and then Thomas Howard, who would become the infamous third Duke of Norfolk, and Muriel Howard, who would later become Viscountess Lisle. So we don't have much direct evidence for Elizabeth's early childhood, for her life during Richard III's reign, but her parents were both loyal Yorkists. So obviously there's a lot of speculation and curiosity surrounding John Howard and Thomas Howard, the Earl of Surrey's involvement in the disappearance of the Princess in the Tower, which is way too tangential, probably a podcast all by itself. But we know that Elizabeth Tilney, this is our Elizabeth's mother, was present at the coronation of Richard III and Anne Neville. And there are claims online that Elizabeth Tilney served in the household of Elizabeth Woodville as well. I couldn't find any evidence for this in primary sources myself. But it seems that our Elizabeth, Elizabeth Howard, later Elizabeth Boleyn, continued and had a pretty normal life until 1485 with the defeat of Richard III in the Battle of Bosworth.
Yes, I think this is a thing people don't understand when it comes to when she marries Boleyn, which Thomas Boleyn, which I'm sure we'll discuss in a bit, because obviously the Howards are a premier family.
Yes.
How did her family survive the fall of Richard III?
Initially, they struggled. So John Howard, who is, again, Elizabeth's grandfather, he was killed at the Battle of Bosworth. And her father was arrested and then taken to the Tower of London because Henry VII backdated his reign to the day before the Battle of Bosworth. So everyone who fought on the side of Richard III was considered a traitor. So Thomas Howard called off to the Tower of London. And then Elizabeth Tilney left their family manor of Ashwellthorpe in Norfolk and took several of her children with her. Possibly Elizabeth went with her, who would have been, she'd have been around 5 years old at this time. And they went to London to get an audience with Thomas Howard or possibly with the king, because obviously Elizabeth Tilney was afraid that her husband was going to be executed. They stayed at the hospital of St. Catherine's by the Tower, which was next to the Tower of London at the time. But they don't seem to be granted the audience that they wanted, because they then leave for the Isle of Sheppey. And we have a surviving letter from Elizabeth Tilney to John Paston of Paston Letters fame, in which she recounts that John Ratcliffe, Lord Fitzwater, in her absence, had dismissed her servants and claimed that they'd spoken out against the king. And they were trying to take Ashwellthorpe Manor for the king, because obviously Thomas Howard had been arrested, and so therefore his lands and possessions were forfeit to the king as a traitor. But Ashwellthorpe Manor was held by right of Elizabeth Tilney, not Thomas Howard. So most of the evidence for all of this comes from this letter from Elizabeth Tilney to John Paston. And she begs Paston to help her. And she knows that she's in a very dangerous situation. That her husband has been accused as a traitor, that he might be executed, that he's been arrested, and that she has gone from, you know, the Countess of Surrey, this very highly regarded woman of standing, to the wife of a traitor. And for anyone who's interested, the letter is freely available online. I really would recommend reading it, because her emotions at the situation really bleed through that letter. You really feel it. So anyway, in the end, Fitzwater couldn't siege Ashwellthorpe because it belonged to Elizabeth Tilney, not Thomas Howard. And then Thomas Howard was eventually released from the Tower in 1489 after swearing an oath of loyalty to Henry VII. And he and his family were then sent to Yorkshire, where Thomas Howard was to act as Lieutenant of the North on the King's behalf. So they lived in Sheriff Hutton Castle. And we actually have some great insight into their lives there in Yorkshire. We have surviving accounts of what they would have eaten on certain days. The household accounts, boiled capon, beef, veal, pie, custard, all sorts. It's wonderful. It's one of those strange historical occurrences where we don't know what they were thinking or feeling. We know what they were eating, though. So Elizabeth grew up in Sheriff Hutton Castle in the company of her sister Muriel and then several other young women who also served in her mother's household. So we have the poem The Garland of the Laurel by John Skelton, which was written in 1495. And this offers us insight into the women that Elizabeth would have spent her teenage years with. So we've got Elizabeth and Muriel, the sisters. We've got Anne Dacre, Marjorie Wentworth, who was the future mother of Jane Seymour, Margaret Tilney, Jane Blenner Hassett, Elizabeth Pennell, Margaret Hussey, Gertrude Statham, and Elizabeth Knight. So these were all of the women that Elizabeth would have spent her teenage years with. And then we've got another occurrence that was huge for the family when Thomas Howard the Younger, this is the future third Duke of Norfolk, married Anne of York, the sister of Elizabeth of York, Henry VII's wife. So this shows that mid-1490s, the family had regained some of their status in order for Thomas Howard the Younger to marry into the royal family. So they were back on the up again. And that's what we have for the direct evidence for what she was up to. Besides that, as I said, when you've got the connective tissue between the bones, she would have received a pretty typical education. For a girl of her social standing, she'd have been taught how to read and write, how to sew and embroider, and she might have been particularly skilled at embroidery because she gifted embroidery to Henry later in her life. She would have learned, you know, how to play chess and cards, to ride and shoot a bow, sing and dance, possibly play a musical instrument, and all of this was intended to set her up for a successful future court career.
Do we know why her father was in prison for 4 years? You know, why was it so long?
And off the top of my head, I can't remember why it took so long. But Kirsten Claydon Yardley has written a biography of Thomas Howard, the second Duke of Norfolk, which covers why he was imprisoned for as long as he was. Off the top of my head, I can't remember why. But yeah, it is out there.
Do we know when Elizabeth first went to court?
So it's often claimed online, and this is one of the first things that drove me to do my own research, because I could see claims online a lot that Elizabeth served in the household of Elizabeth of York. And I thought, did she? That's really interesting. Try to go to the primary sources and find that. No evidence at all. I cannot find evidence of Elizabeth Boleyn or Elizabeth Howard at this point in the household of Elizabeth of York. I can't find any evidence of her presence at court until Henry VIII's reign. And she first appears in court records in 1509 at the coronation of Henry and Catherine. So she might have attended court by then. Her family seemed to have returned south from Yorkshire by late 1499, because her father was present at the trial of Perkin Warbeck in November. But we don't have any direct evidence of Elizabeth at court until 1509.
Right, but she possibly could have been there, but we just don't have the proper confirmation until 1509.
Until later, yes. She could have possibly been there any time from 1499 to 1509, but in terms of her actual name appearing in a document, that is in the records of the accounts of clothing drawn up in preparation for the coronation. And she appears in lists of attendance to the Queen, and she appears in accounts of clothing that was given to women who would be at the coronation. That's her first appearance.
Right, okay. Do we know when Elizabeth first met her future husband, Thomas Boleyn?
So it's impossible to date this accurately. We don't have a surviving date for their marriage. They met sometime towards the end of the 15th century, possibly in 1499 or 1500. So at the earliest, it was in 1498, which was the earliest possible date that the Howards seem to have returned south. And then we've got the date of the marriage of Muriel, who was Elizabeth's younger sister, who was married by the end of 1500. So it seems likely that Elizabeth met and married Thomas before then as the elder sister. And the latest date we have for their marriage, they were certainly married before the 10th of July, 1501, when Elizabeth's jointure was settled upon her. So we have a couple of year window where they met and got married.
I mean, you've kind of already answered this, but why did she marry Thomas Boleyn? Was she not higher in rank compared to him?
So the Howards and the Boleyns had actually known each other for around 20 years before Thomas and Elizabeth married each other. Thomas's father, William Boleyn, acted as John Howard's deputy when John Howard was made the Admiral of England. And Dr. Claire Martin covers this in her book, Heirs of Ambition. And Claire suggests in her book that that perhaps William Boleyn had a position in John Howard's household. So there's that family link already. And then we have to remember as well that although the Howards were back up on the rise at this point, at the time of Elizabeth's marriage to Thomas, they were still somewhat diminished after the imprisonment of her father. So the antiquary, William Camden, suggests that the marriage was arranged by Thomas Howard. That Thomas Howard, this being Thomas Howard, Elizabeth's father, everyone's called Thomas Howard, I apologise. Thomas Howard, second Duke of Norfolk, he chose Thomas Boleyn to marry his daughter. And we also, I think, have to allow for the possibility that Elizabeth and Thomas met and perhaps fell in love. Perhaps they liked each other. I mean, it's probably more likely that it was arranged by their families, that it was mutually beneficial. But we have to allow for the possibility that they liked each other as well. Maybe they fell in love. But it does seem to be a family arrangement.
Right. Yeah, I do get that from what I've seen. They could have possibly grown to love each other, but it was probably in a family arrangement, which was the case of many Tudor marriages.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. A case of marriage of mutual convenience, I think.
Yes. Do we know possibly where Elizabeth's main residence was, if she went home once she was married, or, you know, was she at court with Thomas, or was she in the country?
So where they lived after their marriage is strongly debated. So as I said, Elizabeth doesn't appear in court documents until a bit later. So she seems to have possibly stayed at home for the first few years after the marriage. And for a long time, it was thought that she and Thomas lived at Hever Castle, but recent scholarship suggests that they lived in Blickling Hall in Norfolk immediately after their marriage. And we don't know We don't know precisely where they lived. Her jointure also granted her the manors of Pashley, Holcombe, and Carbrook, so she might have stayed in one of those. However, her main residence was probably Hever in Kent, which was the family seat after the death of Thomas's father in 1505. And the Boleyns also owned the manors of Blickling Hall and Luton Hoo, so Elizabeth might have stayed there. Basically, Thomas Boleyn had a very large and impressive property portfolio, which allows that Elizabeth seems to have gone to the country and not stayed at court, because, as I say, she doesn't appear in court documents until later. And also, we've got the birth of the children as well, seemingly quite soon after Thomas and Elizabeth were married.
Yeah, I think from, obviously, we don't know exactly when Anne and Mary are definitely born, mm-hmm. but it's about 1501 to 1506 is the window for the children being born. So it makes sense that she was probably in the country somewhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, not at court. Or at the court, then only intermittently.
Yeah, probably like, hello, and then, oh, I'm pregnant again. I've got to get her.
Exactly.
Do we know of how close she was with any of her children?
So we don't have much evidence, if any, actually, for her relationships with George and Mary. However, she was obviously very close to Anne. So in one of the few surviving letters that we have from Anne to her friend Bridget Wingfield, Anne wrote, "Assuredly next to mine own mother, I know of no woman alive that I love better." So it's obvious that Anne cared very deeply for her mother and that this must have gone both ways. I'd imagine that Elizabeth was close to George and Mary as well, because she was involved in their early education, probably. And she was there raising them in those early years before she began her own court career. We just don't have the direct evidence to say.
Do we know? I think, I'm not sure if it's confirmed. Obviously, we know Mary, George and Anne went into adulthood. But did they have any other children that didn't survive?
So we know that Thomas and Elizabeth had five children. They were, as we know, Mary, Anne and George. And then there were two sons, Thomas and Henry. And the birth order of Mary, Anne and George is generally agreed upon, with Mary being the eldest and then George being the youngest. And where Thomas and Henry fit into that birth order is difficult to say, because the only evidence that they ever lived are two small grave markers. Thomas's is in St. John the Baptist Church in Penshurst, and Henry's is in St. Peter's Church in Hever. And I do go into this in the book, you know, theories about the birth order of the children and where Thomas and Henry might fit into the order, who was born first and all of that. But I think suffice to say, Thomas and Elizabeth certainly lost two children, probably in infancy, judging by the size of those crosses. And I think that we imagine that perhaps people in the early modern period loved their children less because infant mortality was quite high. But I would imagine, just because we have silence in the sources, it does not mean that our loss was any less painful for them as a couple. So they had, as I say, three children that survived adulthood and two that we know of who died in infancy.
Yeah, I think it's one of those myths about the 16th, well, not even just the 16th century, just going back in history, that because mothers of a noble position probably just didn't care about their children.
Yeah, because they were so used to them dying, which is a dreadful thing to think. You know, I think we need to allow the people of the past the same depth of emotion that we feel. It's the loss of a child. You know, it's terribly tragic. And writing about it for the book was incredibly difficult and sad, because from a practical standpoint, all you have as a historian is a grave marker and the name. Thomas Boleyn, you know, son of Thomas Boleyn, I think it says off the top of my head, something like that. But behind that survival, it must have been dreadful for them.
No, I completely agree. I think I'm using Henry VIII as an example. When the children he had with Catherine and Anne died, and when Henry Fitzroy died, he was very visibly upset. I think even though infant mortality was high, it was still a shock and it was still painful, because it's the thing now, it's you shouldn't outlive your children.
Absolutely. And I think as well, because it was two boys for Thomas and Elizabeth, you place the hope of your dynasty in those boys as well. You know, they had two daughters and one son in the end that survived adulthood. And it the loss of those two small children, yeah, it must have been very sad.
Absolutely. Moving forward, what do we know what Elizabeth's role was at the Tudor court during the early years of Henry and Catherine's marriage and reign?
So there was definitely a Lady Boleyn in Catherine of Aragon's service from 1509 to around 1522. And there's strong evidence to suggest this was Elizabeth Boleyn. This is Elizabeth Howard Boleyn. There are two other candidates, Elizabeth Wood Boleyn, the wife of James Boleyn, and Anne Tempest Boleyn, the wife of Edward Boleyn, who can almost certainly be ruled out. So James Boleyn wasn't knighted until 1515 or 1516. So his wife would have been Mistress Boleyn before then. And then Anne Tempest didn't marry Edward Boleyn until 1517. So any references to a Lady Boleyn at court before 1517 can't be her either. And then Edward Boleyn seems to have not been at court very often. He doesn't appear in court records. And so he and then likely his wife seem to have stayed away. And then in accounts for Henry and Catherine's coronation, Elizabeth is referred to as Dame Elizabeth Boleyn. And then there is a reference to Elizabeth Boleyn in a surviving seating chart for a banquet in July 1517. And then a Lady Boleyn appears in different lists drawn up of Catherine's household. So I'd say the most persuasive evidence that this is our Elizabeth Boleyn and that she had the position in Catherine's household is the fact that Thomas Boleyn had a position in the king's service. So it was common for court couples to serve alongside one another, with the husband being in the king's household and the wife being in the queen's household. So it seems like Elizabeth Boleyn served in Catherine of Aragon's household as a lady-in-waiting from 1509. And that role would have included things like keeping the queen company in public and in private, attending jousts, pageants, banquets, entertaining foreign ambassadors, and basically just being a companion for the queen and representing her as part of her entourage.
Yeah, I mean, it would make sense that Elizabeth went to serve the new Tudor queen because, to be honest, I was just thinking it as we were talking then. Obviously, Elizabeth of York dies in 1503, so there was probably no need for ladies-in-waiting.
Yeah, so there was that period, and you've got the fall of the Howard family means that you, and they were up in Yorkshire, so that covers that period. And then, as you say, Elizabeth of York's death means that there would be no need for ladies-in-waiting from then on. And you've got Muriel Howard, so this is Elizabeth's sister, does appear seemingly at important events during Henry VII's reign. She's there at, for example, Elizabeth of York's funeral. This is Muriel. But by this point, Muriel Howard was Viscountess Lisle. So she would have been what they called an extraordinary, a member of court, meaning that she had a particular social standing that meant that she had to appear at important court events like funerals, christenings, that sort of thing, coronations, whatever it might be. You know, there are women of a certain status who appear at big, important national events. That seems to be Muriel who did that. But as I say, we have no evidence that Elizabeth Boleyn did that. Only being the wife of Thomas Boleyn, wasn't her younger sister was of higher status than her. So we have evidence of Muriel Howard at court during Henry VII's reign, but not of Elizabeth Boleyn.
Well, that's interesting, actually. But as you say, obviously, there was a circumstance that made her be at court. Yes. She was married to Lord Lisle.
Yes.
Yes, Lord Lisle.
Yeah.
When Elizabeth, if the records are, if we're right, did she have any significance with the Queen? You know, did she hold a bit of influence with her?
So, again, this is where the speculation comes in. We don't have any direct evidence. As a Howard, and then as the wife of Thomas Boleyn, who was himself an important ambassador, she would have likely held some sway. And she was also a high-ranking woman in the Queen's service. So she probably did have some influence and some power, but we don't have the surviving evidence of what she did personally. And then definitely later in life, as Anne's position increased, Elizabeth's would also have increased as Anne gained prominence with Henry. And we have evidence that Elizabeth was involved in appointing women to Anne's household, for example. But as I say, that's later in life.
That's later.
At this point in her early career, we can't say for certain, but we know that as a Howard and then as Thomas Boleyn's wife, possibly.
A bit of a random question, but do we know if Elizabeth had any particular close friends in life that she had from a young age or at court?
So, as I said earlier, we've obviously got the women that were in her mother's household when she was growing up in Yorkshire. And then we have direct evidence for her friendship with the Lestrange family. Their household accounts survive, and they record that Elizabeth visited them on a particular date. And then we've got the women who she would have served alongside in Catherine of Aragon's household. And then the women in her own family. So her sister Muriel, possibly her half-sisters Margaret Bryan and Anne Dacre. And then we've got Elizabeth Stafford as well, tantalizingly Elizabeth Stafford. So here I'm going to briefly take a sidebar and say that Muriel Howard died in childbirth in December 1512. And the women at Muriel Howard's funeral were all family by blood or marriage. But Elizabeth Stafford appears there at Muriel Howard's funeral, and she also appears at the banquet in July 1517 in that surviving seating chart. And she was also at Henry and Anne's coronation. So Elizabeth Stafford infamously married Thomas Howard, the third Duke of Norfolk, our Elizabeth's brother. And they had a terribly unhappy marriage. And Elizabeth Stafford stood by Catherine of Aragon during the King's Great Matter. And so if we assume, and I realise that it's very sparse evidence, but if we assume that Elizabeth Stafford and Elizabeth Boleyn knew each other and possibly were friends, or at least knew of each other, then Elizabeth Stafford's marriage to Thomas Howard, 3rd Duke of Norfolk, and Anne Boleyn's rise and the fall of Catherine of Aragon would have caused a rift between Elizabeth Boleyn and Elizabeth Stafford. And there's a lot of speculation there, I realise, I will stress that. But it's very interesting to imagine. And then the other friend of Elizabeth's who is worth mentioning is Honor Grenville, Viscountess Lyle, who lived in Calais. And as her husband was the Lord Deputy of Calais, her husband being Arthur Plantagenet. And the Lyle letters are an excellent source, and Elizabeth Boleyn is mentioned in a few of them. So, for example, in a letter written in April 1536, Thomas Worley mentions that Honor sent Elizabeth Boleyn a pair of hosen and to thank Honor for them on Elizabeth's behalf. So it's unknown when Honor, Lady Lyle, and Elizabeth Boleyn became friends, or whether they kept up their own correspondence, but obviously they exchanged gifts and they seem to have stayed in touch. So Elizabeth had a wider network than I think has been allowed. Plus you've obviously got the Wyatt family living locally as well, and Anne Boleyn's infamous possible romantic connection with Thomas Wyatt in her youth. Elizabeth Boleyn, while we don't have a lot of direct evidence, we have some.
Again, is it one of those things where it's kind of overlooked a little bit? As you say, I was looking up because I've got a copy of the Lyle Letters book, and I'm like, I didn't see that when I was reading it, so I'm going to have to go back later tonight and find this mention.
There's a few mentions. She's referenced at that point in that particular letter as Lady Wiltshire.
Oh, okay.
Becoming Countess of Wiltshire later in life. So, yeah, look for references to Lady Wiltshire.
Get the book now. Do we know if Elizabeth accompanied the English court to the field of the cloth of gold?
Yes, she did. And this is the only time that we know of that she actually left England. So she appears in several lists as a member of the Queen's retinue with the rank of Baroness, which is also the rank that she was afforded at Henry and Catherine's coronation. This entitled her to bring two female attendants, three male servants, and six horses with her. And she was also accompanied by her sister-in-law, Anne Tempest Boleyn, and then her daughter Mary Boleyn, who are also in the Queen's retinue. So we know that she was there, as always, as a member of the Queen's household. She would have been there at, you know, the various events that went on at the Field of Cloth of Gold, representing the Queen at this very important event.
I mean, I think it's wonderful to think that someone that there's not a lot of historical documents about, we know she was one of the most important events of Henry VIII's reign.
She was there. And I think there's a lot made of Anne Boleyn's presence at the Field of Cloth of Gold. Possibly Anne was there. We don't know that Anne was there for certain, but we know for certain that Elizabeth Boleyn was.
Yeah, we think we know that Anne was there, and it's probably quite likely she was there.
Yes, absolutely. Very likely that she was there. This would have been the first time that Elizabeth Boleyn saw Anne since she'd left for France as well, since she'd left for her foreign education. So it's very interesting to imagine if they met there again, if they reunited there again, what it was like for Elizabeth to see her daughter after all this time. Yeah.
I think as you were saying before, it's so hard not to think of the emotions that run between these historical people, because you're probably like, oh, if they did see each other, it must have been so emotional. It's like, but we don't know that. And it's so hard not to be able to say that.
Exactly, we won't say that with any certainty. To say maybe, perhaps, all the time. If I was to do a keyword search through the draft of my book, I think the phrase perhaps would come up hundreds and hundreds of times.
I mean, sadly with history, it is always a, this could have been what happened, but we don't know.
No. Like the one that I love is the theory that Anne Boleyn possibly met Leonardo da Vinci.
Oh, that keeps coming about, doesn't it?
Everyone says that, and you're like, I want to imagine that maybe she did, but we don't know. Or it's in The Spanish Princess, isn't it, where young Catherine of Aragon meets Christopher Columbus in the TV adaptation of Spanish Princess. And you're like, I'd like to imagine that that happened.
Don't tease me with possibilities. We know that Anne Boleyn returns to the English court in 1522, but it isn't until 1525-26 that Henry VIII takes a romantic interest in Anne. Do we know where Elizabeth was at this time? Was she at Hever? Was she at court?
She seems to have been at Hever at this point. We don't have any direct evidence for her involvement at this very early stage before it got official, if you like, before they started courting. Given Mary Boleyn's brief relationship with Henry, for which we have very little direct evidence as well, actually, it needs to be said, a lot is made of Mary Boleyn's romantic entanglement with Henry VIII, but we don't have much direct evidence for it. It's probably likely that Elizabeth Boleyn wasn't overjoyed when the king took an interest in Anne. In the beginning, she and Thomas wouldn't have imagined that Anne would be anything more than a mistress to Henry, and they'd already had one daughter in that position. So they would have, I think, as Anne's parents, wanted her to make a good marriage and were probably not supportive of the relationship at first. However, it's also interesting to remember that when Anne was removed from court in around 1525-26, then when Henry's love letters seem to have begun, Elizabeth was at Hever at that point. So it would have been Elizabeth who was there when the letters were delivered, often by George, who was sometimes acting as a courier. And there's a tantalising reference in one of Henry's love letters to Anne, where he says that Anne would not come to court, even with her mother present. And he wrote, "The opinion in which I left you is totally changed, and you would not come to court either with your mother, or if you could, or if in any other manner." So it's really interesting to speculate, was this because Anne didn't want to go to court, or because Elizabeth didn't want her to go? Like so much, I feel like I've said this so many times during our conversation, we don't know, but it's interesting to speculate that it was possibly Elizabeth who didn't want Anne to go back to court at this period.
Yeah, I think I've never really seen the letter like that. I don't know why I've never seen that. Obviously, you're researching Elizabeth, so you'll see it from that aspect.
Yeah.
It's interesting to think that, obviously, we know Anne and Elizabeth were close, that she probably really valued her mother's opinion.
Absolutely. Yeah, her mother's opinion, her mother's insight into this. Possibly Elizabeth knew about what had happened with Mary Boleyn. You know, again, gaps everywhere, but speculation to fill them, you know. And I think that it's because I'm researching Elizabeth, any reference to Anne's mother, I leapt on it, you know, when I was gathering the sources, the tiniest of references to Lady Wiltshire, or at a certain point she was Lady Rochford, to Elizabeth Boleyn, you grab it and you form the picture. And it is, as I say, just this tiny tantalizing reference to Henry saying, you will not come to court, either alone or with your mother. It's just very interesting.
No, I completely agree. When Anne had meetings with Henry at court, when she did go back to court, is it true that Elizabeth was Anne's chaperone?
So, yes, it is. It's one of the few things that is often repeated about Elizabeth when she's mentioned at all in biographies of Anne. We do have evidence that Elizabeth was often in Anne's company during her courtship with the king, from letters written about Anne from this time. So Shapwe mentions, for instance, that Anne and Elizabeth went with Henry to inspect the contents of York Place after Cardinal Wolsey's fall. And Elizabeth seems to have accompanied Anne and Henry during this period to ensure that nothing improper happened before they were married. It was a propriety thing. Mm. So she was there, yeah, just to make sure that everything was above board.
Obviously, she was there to make sure nothing happened. Is it important that it was Elizabeth, or could it have been anyone that Anne picked?
I think it was probably other people as well. You know, George, you've got possibly other members of the family who had taken an interest at this point. I don't think it necessarily had to be Elizabeth, but the fact that it was Elizabeth also speaks into those rumours that I'm sure we'll talk about later, that are often repeated about Elizabeth Boleyn, that she had a romantic engagement with Henry VIII at some point. You know, these bonkers rumours that came around 1535 that Elizabeth Boleyn and Henry VIII had some kind of relationship. And they seem to have been put about just to cause scandal, just to slander Anne, and just to therefore slander Elizabeth. You want to slander Anne, you go after the mother. The same thing happened with other queens consorts as well. You think about Elizabeth Woodville and the accusations against Duchetta of Luxembourg, her mother. So I think that the fact that Elizabeth, that we know that Elizabeth chaperoned Anne and Henry during their courtship, suggests that there was nothing between Henry VIII and Elizabeth Boleyn, because Elizabeth Boleyn was trusted in that position to chaperone that relationship.
No, that's interesting. Obviously, we think, or we kind of know, that Elizabeth was lady-in-waiting possibly to Catherine of Aragon. Do we think it would have been hard for Elizabeth to... Obviously, she was going to be on her daughter's side. Do you think it was... Obviously, it's speculation. Do you think Elizabeth found it hard that she had to kind of put all her loyalty behind her daughter and not the queen?
I think so. I think probably, again, speculation, but she served Catherine for over 10 years. She wore her livery. She was there. Possibly she was present during Catherine's stillbirths because, you know, we know that only women were allowed in the room. Possibly she was there during those very difficult times. So I think that it must have been very difficult for Elizabeth to have to choose between her queen and her daughter. Ultimately, obviously, we know she chose Anne, we know she chose family. Whether this was difficult, whether she was, you know, a cold and proud woman, as has sometimes been suggested, who was, you know, wanting what's best for our family and was power hungry, just like Thomas, or whether it was a difficult position for her to be put in, we don't know. Personally, I'd like to think that it was, because I think you always end up falling in love with your biographical subjects and you want to think the best in them where you can. We don't know if it was difficult. I would imagine that it probably was.
No, I obviously, we don't have recorded or documented evidence, because obviously that's quite private for even then.
Yeah.
But I can imagine a lot of people that were related to Anne probably found it very hard to not have that loyalty to the Queen.
Yeah, to be put in that position. It was a very difficult position, I think, for a lot of people to be in, to choose sides.
No, I completely agree. So I've kind of asked that. Did Elizabeth play a significant role in Anne's queenship?
So as the mother of an English queen consort, Elizabeth was actually in a very difficult position. Joanna Lane Smith, in her wonderful book, The Last Medieval Queens, discusses the difficult role that English queen consorts' mothers were in, given that the relationship between mothers and daughters were viewed with suspicion, and the husband obviously was supposed to rule the wife. And so having your mother there was just difficult for, you know, the king. The mothers of English queen consorts previous to Anne seem to have taken a back seat during their daughters' queenships. For example, you've got Elizabeth Woodville, the mother of Elizabeth of York, who famously retired to Bermondsey Abbey in 1487, only returning to court occasionally. We don't know exactly why she did this, but then we've also got the other queen's mothers, Duchess of Luxembourg, Elizabeth Woodville's mother, and Anne Beauchamp, or Beecham, I've only ever seen it written down, Anne Neville's mother, also remain elusive in the sources. So it seems that Elizabeth Boleyn took a back seat during Anne's queenship, as previous English queen consorts' mothers did. However, given her wealth of experience of court life and queenship from her service to Catherine of Aragon, it's likely that she did offer her opinions and advice. And it seems that she was involved in the appointment of ladies to Anne Boleyn's household. She suggests at one point that Elizabeth Barton, the Holy Maid of Kent, take up a position in Anne Boleyn's household. So it does seem that Elizabeth Boleyn was involved in perhaps some of the appointments in Anne's household. But besides that, we can't say for certain whether she played a significant role in Anne's queenship, simply because precedent suggested that she wouldn't have done.
Yeah, no, I get that. Do we, as you were saying, you know, she kind of did what her predecessors as a queen mother-in-law did and took a bit of a backseat. Do we know if she was at court, or did she retire to Hever almost?
We do have some references to her in things like the New Year's gift rolls, and she likely seems to have travelled between court and Hever where necessary, but it is unfortunately difficult to place her at court often during Anne's queenship. However, she was definitely present enough, as I mentioned earlier, that those rumours began swirling in 1535 that she'd had a relationship with Henry. The earliest reference to these rumours that I could find was in April 1535. So she must have had enough of a presence at court and been on people's minds enough that it was worth mentioning, even if it was only just to slander Anne. So, yes, it seems like she did take a back seat somewhat, but we do have some evidence of her presence there at various points throughout Anne's queenship.
Yeah, so she probably wasn't a political powerhouse, but she probably was still enough of a figure that people were like, okay, if we insult her, that will get to Anne.
Exactly, yes.
Do we know if Elizabeth spent any time with her granddaughter, also Elizabeth?
Tragically, as I've said so often, we do not have the surviving evidence for this, and we can speculate that she spent time with her, she was her granddaughter, but there's no, that I could find, there's no document where you point to it and you say Elizabeth Boleyn and Elizabeth were, you know, the younger Elizabeth were in the room together at this particular point. It's, we don't have any direct evidence. I'd imagine so, given how close Anne was to her daughter.
Yeah.
And given how much she obviously loved Elizabeth, the younger Elizabeth, it seemed likely.
In, I think, 1534, if I'm remembering correctly, Mary, Anne's elder sister, we think, again, more speculation.
Yeah, it's the theme of this conversation.
Was banished from court for marrying William Stafford and also being pregnant. Do we know if Elizabeth said or did anything or how she felt at her daughter being banished?
So, as a Howard, I would imagine that Elizabeth had a strong sense of her own status, and then, of course, the family status at this point. You know, even besides the fact that, you know, the Boleyns were on the rise, Elizabeth herself was a Howard, and so she would have understood the importance of social status and the importance of marrying below your station. So she probably wasn't very happy with Mary. And in Mary's letter to Thomas Cromwell, when she asked him for help, she wrote, "I beseech you, good master secretary, pray my lord, my father, and my good lady to be so good to us, and to let me have their blessings and my husband their goodwill." So I think the lady that she's referencing is probably Anne in that letter. It might have been Elizabeth, because I'd imagine she would have said mother if she was referencing Elizabeth. But if we read it in a certain way, it could have been a reference to Elizabeth also being on the side of Thomas Boleyn and, you know, being on board with Mary's banishment from the family. It's interesting, both Mary and Elizabeth Boleyn being such shadowy figures, being such difficult figures to access in the sources, given how brightly Anne shines and how much we feel we know Anne. When you look at the two women beside her, her mother and her sister, they are much more difficult to see. So we don't know how Elizabeth felt about it. I would imagine that she probably agreed with the banishment. As sad as that is for us to imagine, it was a matter of social standing and their position.
No, I agree. I think probably as a mother, she wanted the best for her children.
Yes.
But I think because she was a Howard, as you say, she probably had a lot more of a affinity to social standing because of what happened to her father, and, you know, they rose back. And yeah, I get what you mean. I think it was probably a mixed thing, but I think with Anne, it was probably for her as well not great to do that to her sister, but from a social standing point of view, again.
Exactly. Not easy, not great, but the done thing, the thing that they probably felt they had to do. Yes, it's a mindset that we find very difficult to access at the moment. You know, we see it as a romantic story. Mary married for love. The letter that she wrote to Thomas Cromwell is beautiful and, you know, articulate and romantic and all of these things. So we like that story. But for the family, what are you doing marrying for love and getting pregnant? You know, I think when you think about it from their point of view, and given how important their rise was at that point and how this could have, you know, ruined everything and it was scandalous and all of that. Yeah, difficult, I think, for the family, but necessary.
Yeah, no, I get what you mean. We don't hate Mary, guys. Just
we don't. No, we don't. We love and support Mary Boleyn on this podcast.
We're just saying how it would have been viewed in the 16th century. Do we know how Elizabeth felt, or if she did anything to counter the rise of Jane Seymour?
This is a huge gap. As I've said, I'm sorry, I feel like a broken record. It's just the missing sources. You know, a lot of my research for the book has been educated speculation, reading against the grain, as I say, to try and create a more full picture. But sometimes you just have to look into a gaping hole in the archive and say, I don't know. I don't know her feelings and her thoughts. I don't know if she did anything. It's so difficult to place her during Anne's queenship, and impossible to know how she reacted or if she tried to do anything to counter the rise of Jane Seymour. Yeah, unfortunately, I won't harp on about it.
No, fair enough. I mean, it was a bit of a difficult question, but obviously, just because of the association of
Marjorie Wentworth.
Obviously.
It's so tantalising, isn't it? They knew each other. You mean Elizabeth Boleyn knew Marjorie Wentworth during their youth? And we don't know anything about that.
Yeah.
All you can say is they knew each other. They spent time together. We know very... Marjorie Wentworth is another figure. I mean, the amount of times I encountered the phrase Elizabeth Boleyn as a shadowy figure during my secondary source research, if I had a pound for every time somebody said that, same with Marjorie Wentworth as well. You know, these people that we'd love to know more about, that we'd love to know what they thought and how they felt, it's just a gap, unfortunately.
No, I mean, sadly, that is the case with many Tudor women. There's gaps in the records. Do we know where Elizabeth was when Anne and George were arrested at the beginning of May 1536?
I would imagine that the last time that Elizabeth saw Anne was at that May Day joust, the last time that Anne saw Henry, that joust. Elizabeth was probably there with her. And then unfortunately, we don't know where she was when her children were arrested. It seems like they removed themselves to Hever pretty quickly. There were rumours swirling around at the time that Thomas and Elizabeth were arrested too, with their children. Obviously, that wasn't true. And I think that speaks more to the general shock of the arrests and the rumour mill that was swirling around. It seems like, well, I mean, the one thing that does tell us is that Thomas and Elizabeth weren't there because people were saying they were arrested. So if they were just at court at that point, then nobody would be saying that. So it seems like they removed themselves to Hever pretty quickly as events started to happen very fast.
Yeah, I mean, I don't blame them.
No, yeah, it must have been very frightening.
Do we, I mean, obviously it's probably their hands were tied, but do we know if Elizabeth or even Thomas tried to do anything to prevent their deaths?
So there's no surviving evidence to suggest that either of them did anything, which, as we've said a couple of times during this conversation, is difficult for us to understand from a modern perspective. But we have to remember that Henry, as the king, was God's representative on earth. What could they do? Thomas has received a lot of vilification and judgment over the centuries for not intervening on behalf of his children. Perhaps he did. Perhaps they did write letters, both Thomas and Elizabeth, which didn't survive. I mean, that's always the easy out, isn't it? Maybe it didn't survive. We don't know. Perhaps they had no choice but to stand back and allow, quote unquote, justice to take its course. We simply don't know if they did anything to try and prevent their deaths. But I think that the vilification of Thomas, that same vilification has not fallen on Elizabeth simply because Elizabeth has been pushed to the shadows and pushed to the sidelines. If we vilify Thomas for not trying to rescue his children from their fates, then we need to allow that same vilification for Elizabeth as well. That being said, I don't think that either of them should be. I think that there was very little that they could do. And it must have been terrible. All I feel is sympathy. God's representative on earth, the king himself, was moving against Anne and George and the other men accused. To have all of that power stripped away so quickly, we know how frightening it was for Anne. We have it from Kingston's letters recording her time in the Tower. And so to be their parents and to have presumably no choice but to remove yourself home and await whatever was going to happen. We don't know when they found out that their children were going to be executed. We don't know how they reacted. We just don't know anything. It's possible that they didn't think that Anne and George were going to be executed because it was such an unprecedented situation to execute an anointed Queen of England that it had never happened before. So it's possible that they didn't actually think that their children were going to die for quite some time. Yeah, it's one of those gaps that is frustrating in the record.
I mean, it's a gap, but I think we can probably imagine the pain they felt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think, as you say, no one was expecting Anne or George or the rest of the men to die.
Yeah, no one was expecting it. Anne herself wasn't expecting it until the very end. She was saying, perhaps I'll be sent to a nunnery.
Mm. I mean, that's what was the, possibly not the done thing, because no one knew what the hell was happening. In them 3 weeks. I mean, even Eustace Shapley's like, wait, they're actually condemned?
Even Eustace Shapley was shocked. Everyone was shocked. It was such a shocking and quick turn of events. Yeah, it's unfortunate we don't have any evidence that their parents intervened on their behalf, but I don't think it speaks to Thomas and Elizabeth not loving them or being cold, heartless monsters.
No, it doesn't speak on them. We don't know.
Because I don't think so.
What could they have done?
Mm-hmm.
Once Elizabeth's children, Anne and George, were executed, do we know how Elizabeth spent her final years?
So she's very scarcely referenced after the deaths of her children, and she seems to have stayed at Hever and not been at court very often. So in May 1537, in a letter to Lady Lyle, John Hussey writes, I will take my Lady Wiltshire's advice on it, referring to it, something in the letter, but we don't know if that meant that she was at court or if he would write to her to get her opinion on this thing. We get a reference to Thomas at court in January 1538, and Elizabeth might have been with him, but again, we don't know. And then she died very soon after the executions of her children. And I think that speaks to how much it must have taken its toll on her. She'd been unwell in 1536, and it's mentioned that she had a cough. And when Anne was arrested in the Tower, she said, "My mother, thou wilt die with sorrow," which again suggests possibly that Elizabeth was unwell, even in 1536, at the time of the arrests, even before the death of her children. Because Anne might have been saying, you know, she would die of sorrow because she was already unwell.
Hmm.
It's been speculated that Elizabeth died of tuberculosis, but I think that grief and loss probably played a part in it, because she died on the 3rd of April, 1538, while staying at the Abbot of Reading's house in London. And we don't know why she was there, but maybe she was already unwell and she'd gone to seek comfort or, you know, guidance or spiritual guidance. And that was very close, if you think about it, to the 3-year anniversary of May 1536, when George and Anne were executed, which I think is telling. It seems that she spent the final years of her life in relative quiet, and she was buried 4 days later on the 7th of April in the Howard Chapel in St. Mary's at Lambeth. And you can still go and see the grave marker in that church. And it's a very sobering experience. It's a very strange experience as well, because actually it's right in front of the desk where you buy your ticket. It's just there in the middle of the gift shop is this headstone. It's a very unassuming slab on the ground. And it's so the fact that she was buried in the Howard Chapel has often been taken as a sign that she and Thomas had had some kind of split during the last years of her life, because she wasn't buried in St. Peter's Church in Hever, where Thomas was buried. But I don't think so. I think that in the end, Elizabeth chose to be buried with her family, which was fairly common for noble women of her status, and shouldn't be read as a sign that they were apart or that they had any split. We don't know if they did, like so many things. But I think that it seems like she and Thomas removed themselves to Hever and then spent those last few years of their lives together at home. Thomas only engaging in court activities when he had to, when he was summoned to, is the impression that I get.
No, I completely agree. I think from the little bit I know of the court records, they both removed themselves. Obviously, we don't know what their marriage was like. You know, we have discussed that. Obviously, we don't know the ins and outs of it. And with grief, usually either drives you together or it drives you apart.
Yeah.
And it could have been either way for the both of them. Maybe they took their comfort together, but it's just, it is so much speculation.
It is, yeah. Like a lot of this, it is so much speculation. It seems to me that it brought them together, but we don't know.
This is more of a question about Thomas, but do we know what Thomas did when Elizabeth died?
There were rumours towards the end of Thomas' life, after the death of Elizabeth, that he was going to get remarried. Lauren Mackay talks about this in her biography of Thomas and George. Never came to pass. You know, obviously he wasn't going to remarry. You know, it was bizarre that even came about. He also didn't survive long after her death. It just seems like it's such a tragic end. That's why we tell the story, isn't it? I think over and over again, we tell the story of the Boleyns because of the unbelievable dramatic rise and then the hubris of it and the tragic fall. It's like Succession, you know, or Breaking Bad or something. All those TV dramas that we love today, those kind of, you know, dramatic stories of the rise and then the hubris and then the fall. And that's really the story of the Boleyns, I think, is this unbelievable rise. Not necessarily unprecedented. I suppose you can see it in the rise of the Woodville family as well. Very similar in that way. But it's, it's the dramatic rise and then the fall.
No, I completely agree. How do you think we should remember Elizabeth? And what do you believe is her legacy?
So I think we should remember Elizabeth. has been virtually written out of Anne Boleyn's story, but she was obviously very important to Anne. So as I said just a moment ago, when Anne was in the Tower, one of the first things she said was, "Oh, my mother." She obviously cared about her mother a great deal. And Elizabeth, I think, needs to be put back into the narrative of Anne's life where possible. We retell Anne's story over and over again, but her mother is a vital missing piece. And obviously we have to, you know, accept that there is a lack of surviving sources, direct surviving sources, but I think that she needs to be put back in Anne's story. But besides that, I think we need to remember Elizabeth in her own right. When I started doing research for my book and I found out that Elizabeth and her family fled their home for the Isle of Sheppey during Elizabeth's childhood, when I found out that Elizabeth had a sister who died in childbirth just 6 months after her own husband died in the worst maritime disaster of Henry VIII's reign, the sinking of the ship the Regent, when I found out that Elizabeth probably had a career serving Catherine of Aragon before Anne ever even returned to England, I knew that I needed to tell the story. She's difficult to see because of a lack of surviving sources, but then what are we supposed to just never tell her story? I think that the stories that we tell are important, and if all we do is repeat the fact that Elizabeth might have had an affair with Henry VIII, for example, but probably not, then that's all we say about her. But there is a lot more to say. She had a life outside of Anne, before Anne, and a very brief life after as well, and I think that her legacy isn't particularly grand. We don't know what she thought, or, you know, we don't know what she felt about a lot of the events, or indeed any of the events that she was involved in. She arguably changed history because she gave birth to Anne. So I suppose that's her legacy. But I think that's kind of a bit problematic to suggest that, you know, a woman's legacy is just who she gave birth to. Because what about everything else? You know, I think that she must have been a much more complex woman than the sources allow us to see, who loved her children a great deal. And we only see her as a shadow now because of the lack of surviving sources. And all I'm trying to do with my book and my research is piece together the fragments of her story and bring her to light as much as it is possible. So I think maybe that's her legacy. Whose stories do we tell? How do we tell them? Why do we tell them? Who's worth remembering and discussing, and who's worth digging into the archive to try and find? When I started this project, I was met with a lot of disbelief, you know, oh, it's not possible. There's not enough out there to write the biography of Elizabeth. But I think that trying to find the people of whom little remains, the marginalized people or the overlooked figures in history, especially women of this period, I think that where you can, they deserve that. And I think that her legacy should be one of a mother who seems to have loved her children a great deal, who certainly Anne loved a great deal and cared about. And I think that she needs to be put back on the map, on the historical map, back in the story as much as we can.
I think that's a really lovely thing to say, and I think it's been so wonderful listening to the research you have done into this overlooked woman in history, which is so often the case in history.
Of course, so many women.
I mean, it's why I started this podcast, is because women are just forgotten about, and we are powerhouses, you know.
Absolutely, I agree. I think that we're in such a time. I owe an awful lot to Susanna Lipscomb and her wonderful course Women in History, which gave me a lot of insight into how we find women, how we find marginalized figures at all in the archive, what we do when there's gaps, how we tell those stories, the techniques that you use in order to do them, which I am applying to my book. And I think we're at such a wonderful point in historical research where we are looking at the stories we tell, whose stories we tell, how you practically do that when the archive is full of holes or problematic in some ways in whose stories we tell and how we tell them. And I think that your podcast is a part of that, you know, bringing these women back. The fact that you focus on Tudor women, it's so exciting. You know, I love it. I think it's brilliant. I think that there needs to be more of it. And there is. We're in such a time at the moment of that kind of research, new stories or retelling old stories from new perspectives. Yeah, it's really exciting.
Absolutely. I completely agree. And I think it's so nice that so many Tudor women, medieval women,
yes,
Saxon, Norman women are coming back to the forefront a little bit. I think it's absolutely amazing, and that's why I did do the podcast, because I think when we think of Tudor women, we think of the six wives of Henry VIII.
Yes.
And not the people like Elizabeth Boleyn, Jane Boleyn, married to George.
Absolutely.
Anna Grenville, Gertrude Black. You know, there's just so many women.
Absolutely. There is. Yeah, there's so many women. And I really look forward to, you know, future episodes of your podcast talking about them, I'm sure, and just uncovering people that we can't even think of off the top of our head. There's so much to be said.
Thank you. Before I let you go, because I realize how much of your time I've taken, I'd like to ask my five fun Tudor questions.
Of course. So
firstly, have you got a Tudor pet peeve?
So from a research standpoint, it's bad handwriting. Give me clear, legible handwriting. The amount of times that I have stared at a document written in secretary hand, like messy secretary hand, because I can just about make it with a regular secretary hand, and gone, what does that say? Yeah, that is a pet peeve of mine. People who couldn't write clearly. Just from a research standpoint, it's very difficult. If that's what you meant.
I mean, anything that winds you up, it can be a shame. If it annoys you, it annoys you.
Yeah, bad handwriting and also bad microfilm as well. When you've got a microfilm document, there's a lot on state papers online. And, you know, it was the best they could do at the time that these things were digitized. But when you can't read it because it's badly digitized, oh, it drives me crazy. I think we're like another trip to the National Archives to look at the document in person then.
I mean, I do get that because I started uni last year and I'm starting to work with documents, and it really winds me up when I can't read it.
Absolutely.
I can't analyse. What is your favourite history book? It can be fiction or non-fiction.
So I don't read a lot of historical fiction, but in terms of historical non-fiction, I've recently read John Callow's The Last Witches of England, which is about the Biddeford witches. And I cried at the end of that book. I had to put it down. The epilogue was so emotional and well written. If you haven't read it, and listeners, if you haven't read it, please read it. It's incredible, especially if you like the stories of women, the stories of overlooked women. It's told in such a emotive way. I'd say that's up there with certainly one of the best historical books I've read recently. Also, I loved Heirs of Ambition by Claire Martin. I thought that was very beautifully written. It balanced research with narrative and bringing these, like we've been talking about, overlooked figures really to the light in a really tangible, articulate way. And then the final one that I've read recently that I thoroughly enjoyed was The Witches of St. Osyth by Marian Gibson, which again had a profound effect on me writing my book currently, because towards the end, she talks about how we tell the stories we tell and why we tell them. And it's just very, very well done. I'd say those. I realized that you only asked for one and I gave three. And there's probably a lot more that I could think of, you know, if I thought a bit longer, but off the top of my head, those are the ones that really had a profound impact on me recently.
No, I mean, that's wonderful. I mean, I need to find the books about the witches you just mentioned. I've read Heirs of Ambition and I agree with you. It was absolutely wonderful.
Yeah.
I think obviously Anne Boleyn and Thomas Boleyn and George Boleyn are the only Boleyns that get remembered, and it's not the before.
Yeah, the before. When I found that Claire Martin's book was coming out, much like you said, when you, I think it was before we started recording this podcast, when you said, I can't believe no one's done this before, or I'm so glad somebody is doing this. When I saw that Claire Martin's book was coming out, my first reaction was, how has nobody done this before? Oh my goodness. There are a lot of Boleyns before the Boleyns, you know, that we know of, before Thomas and Anne, I mean. And yeah, that's a brilliant book. If you know, listeners, if you haven't read it, it's fantastic. Yeah.
I mean, I've not read it, but it's just come out. It's The Sons of Prophecy by Nathan Arman.
Yes, it is on my shelf. I'm looking at it right now.
I haven't bought it yet. I'm trying to be good. But it's like, how has no one wrote about the Tudors before Henry VII?
Yeah, oh. Yeah, Nathan Arman is such a huge inspiration of mine. I think his passion for history and how he, I haven't read Son of Prophecy yet, but his book on the Tudor Pretenders, fantastic. So well written, so well researched. Yeah, shout out to Nathan Arman and his book, which I haven't read, but I'm sure will be one of my favourites when I do get to.
Have you got a favourite history film if you do watch them?
I don't actually watch a lot of history films. But I'm a huge fan of historical TV. So as I said earlier, I really enjoyed Wolf Hall. And then I will say Outlander is a guilty pleasure of mine. I don't know how you feel about it. I enjoy it. I think it's a lot of fun.
I like the beginning series.
I agree. The first series is very good. It goes off the rails when they go to France, and I was really bored. But yeah, the first series, I think, is very well done.
I mean, fair enough. There's a lot of historical TV series out there. It might surprise some listeners, but I actually really like I, Claudius in the 1970s.
Really? I've not seen that one. Oh, yes. And I need to watch more history films. There's so many. I want to watch all of the, you know, adaptations of Anne's story. I know there's a lot out there. I need to see more of it. I need to watch more history films.
Yeah, that's on your to-do list after the podcast. Have you got a favourite Tudor building?
It has to be Hever Castle. I think because Ed's, of course, the correct answer, right? I'm on this podcast talking about Elizabeth Boleyn. It has to be Hever Castle. Because of, like I say, it's a very early memory of mine going there, visiting there. And it's such a beautiful place. And I think to stand where we know the Boleyns lived, to be somewhere that's relatively unchanged from how it was when they knew it, somewhere that was so special to them, it's a wonderful experience. You know, it has to be. Hever Castle. I still need to get there. I don't know if you've been, but I need to get there and see the Boleyn apartments.
I know. I need to go.
I see the pictures and I've seen, you know, the media coverage of it, and I have to go.
I mean, yeah, you might get really emotional. You might be like, oh, Elizabeth.
I think I will. I think in light of the book, you know, I want to go there for research purposes. I'd love to see what's been done to recreate the apartments as they were. It looks brilliant from what I've seen from photos online.
Finally, have you got a favourite Tudor history fact?
Yes, I do, and it's very silly. I love how much they ate eels. So I was looking at accounts for food at a banquet for the book the other day, actually, and I saw eels on the menu, and I got so excited because it's so weird. It's so weird. And, you know, if anyone is interested in the history of eels as currency and delicacy, follow the surprised eel historian on Twitter, because his weird historical eel facts are very funny. And it was through his Twitter account and his research into eels in history that made me think, gosh, people did eat a lot of eels back then. And then when I was looking at this, as I say, banquet menu, and I saw that Elizabeth, I think it was a banquet, or it might have been just food that was available at court, I can't remember. But basically, we have evidence Elizabeth ate eels. Elizabeth Boleyn ate eels. And it's one of those bonkers survivals of history that I just love. It's like, we don't know what she thought about anything in her life, but there are certain points, because of the bizarre survivals of documents, that we can say for certain we know what clothes she wore at certain events, and we know what food she ate. So I think that is probably my favourite Tudor fact, because it's so silly and strange.
That's amazing. I think that's brilliant.
I don't imagine that's what you thought I was going to say.
No, I did not think you were going to say that, but I think that's the best fact I've had so far from a guest.
Oh, brilliant. That's the high praise indeed. Thank you.
I mean, weird Tudor fact for you and my listeners is I'm from Chester, so I'm north. Up north, there was in the reign of Mary the First, obviously a lot of Protestants were burned. Mm-hmm. Only one person from Chester was burnt.
Really?
And his name was George Marsh.
Oh, that's very interesting. Yeah. I actually live, so I live in Oxford, and very close by Broad Street, there's a stones on the ground. There's like a small area that's clearly marked out. And there's a plaque nearby, and it is where the Oxford martyrs were burned. And passing that is always very emotional. I pass it on the way to the Radcliffe Camera Library in Oxford. And you can't help but look and just, I mean, obviously it's probably not exactly where that little demarcation is, but, you know, roughly somewhere on that street. Yeah, that's very emotional, passing that and thinking, gosh, somewhere on this street, you know, near where I am, people were put to death.
I think sometimes people forget that you, especially in down in London and down south, especially, like, I'm not saying the north doesn't have history, but when you walk on a street, it's like that event happened there. It's like, wow.
Yeah, it's incredible. I went to Hampton Court Palace just a couple of weeks ago, having never been before, but having read about it so much, you know, for the book and just generally in research, reading about the Tudors, to be there in the so-called haunted gallery, you know, and to be there in Hampton Court at all, and to think, wow, this is where it happened. Here I am now. And there they were then. It's incredible. Yeah.
No, absolutely. Thank you so much for coming on and talking about your research into Elizabeth Boleyn. You've said the book is coming out next year, late next year.
Yes, end of next year. Yes, I will not put a firm date on it yet. It currently still is a work in progress draft on my computer. But yes, end of next year. And thank you so much for having me. Honestly, it's been such a pleasure to share this research.
No, and just thank you for coming on and talking about Elizabeth Boleyn, a figure that I think a lot of people need to give a bit more love to.
Yeah, I agree. And I just hope that people appreciate the research and the love that's gone into the work of the book. And it's been a labour of love, certainly, and it will continue to be. So thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to talk about it and share it.
My pleasure.
If you enjoyed this episode and you loved all the others, please take the time to rate and review the show.